Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Welcome to the Reformed Church of Los Angeles. May the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus be with you.
Also with you.
Lord, you are present before we invoke your presence. Our spirit bestowed at Pentecost promised to us always. So we rejoice in your presence and your promise, and we ask you to move among us as we worship together.
You know our prayers and our concerns. You know our trials and tribulations. You know our joys and our sorrows. And in all that we are nothing without you.
So today we come to you and worship from a multitude of moments, from a variety of backgrounds, from all walks of living, yet one in spirit.
Thank you.
Y'all may be seated. Family, let us begin to prepare our hearts and minds for God's message to us today. Let us come before the Lord with all truth and sincerity. Let us be frank as we confess while we claim to celebrate the ascension of our Lord. The way we live proclaims our lack of faith in His power to deal with this world. Let us confess the inconsistencies between our faith and practice. In prayer, I see myself as nothing. I find my heart going after You with intensity and with a long, vehement thirst to live to You. Blessed be the strong yields of the Spirit that speeds me on my way to the New Jerusalem. In prayer, all things here below vanish, and nothing seems important but the holiness of heart and the salvation of others. In all my worldly cares, fears, and anxieties disappear, and we are of little significance as a puff of wind. In prayer, my soul inwardly exalts with lively thoughts of what You are doing for Your church, and I long that You should give Yourself a great gain from sinners returning to Zion. In prayer, I am lifted above the frowns and flatteries of life, and taste heavenly joys entering into the eternal world. I can give myself to You with all my heart to be Yours forever. In prayer, I can place all my concerns in Your hands to be entirely at Your disposal, having no will or interest of my own. In prayer, I can intercede for my friends, ministers, sinners, the church, Your kingdom to come, with the greatest freedom ardent hopes as a son to his father, as a lover to the beloved. Help me to be all prayer and to never cease praying. Family, we now have the privilege to come before our Lord and confess our sins and need of a Savior. Let us take a moment of silent confession before God and one another. Family, know that in Jesus, God embraces you, forgives you, strengthens you to live a life renewed. Thanks be to God.
Requires us to receive, observe, and keep pure and entitled all such religious worship ordinances as God has appointed in His Word. Deuteronomy 12:32 tells us, "Everything that I command you, you shall be careful to do. You shall not add to it or take away from it." Matthew 28:30 says, "Teach them to observe all that I have commanded you, and behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." And so God commands us to keep our worship in accord with His Word, but we are not to add to it or take away from it. We call this the regulative principle of worship. Okay, what that means is that everything that we do in the worship service, or worship to God in general, ought to be regulated by the Scripture, meaning it ought to be found in Scripture, prescribed in Scripture to us. And we should not be doing anything to worship God that is forbidden to us, and that we should be doing all that God has commanded us to do. And pray that we would be a church that is known for being biblical and for doing all things that God has commanded us to do. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
We're just going to pray for all the kids.
Yeah.
Show us Christ, O Lord. Show us the Son. Show us the Savior. Show us Christ. Oh God, reveal your glory through the preaching of your word until every heart confesses Christ is Lord. Show us Christ, O Lord. Show us Christ. And all of God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. May God show us Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Pastor Reed. I am one of the pastors here. And I want to welcome you all this morning. I want to say how grateful we are that you be with us today to worship the risen Christ on this Lord's Day. But before I get into my sermon, I want to take a minute to acknowledge some awesome young men and women who are here with us today. For the past couple of weeks, our church has partnered with the Compton Leaders Internship Program, and these young men and women are learning some pretty awesome life skills. They are being poured into by other godly men and women, and every morning they begin with prayer and devotions. They put God at the center of what they're doing by starting each and every day with Him by focusing on His Word. Can I please have all the Compton Leader interns and mentors stand, please? Please bring your hands down here. We have to take a moment to pray for you all, to bless you, and to encourage you to continue doing what you're doing. If you are nearby, please feel free to put a hand on if it's appropriate. If not, just first extend a hand towards them, and let's pray and bless them. Amen? Lord, we thank you for these young men and women, and we pray for them. As they are at vulnerable times in their lives, Lord, we pray that all that they have learned, that all that has been poured into them, all of the seeds planted and watered will bear much fruit for your kingdom. That they would be godly young men and women, that they would know their worth, their true value, and will keep themselves pure. That they remain focused on you, and that they continue to seek you, and that you would be found, that they would truly know you, and that they would truly love you, that their belief in you, Lord, would be evident, that they would be counted among your people, and that they would go out and make disciples, that they would love their enemies as themselves, and Lord, that they would be saved. We pray for their hearts, we pray for their minds, and Lord, we pray for their strength, that when they are tempted by the enemy, that the enticements of this world will not overcome them. They will not overcome the joy of the Lord. So bless them, Lord. May no one despise them from their youth. May they be examples in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. And we pray for the Metro CDC staff, Lord, and we pray for the navigators and all those leading these college and high school young men and women. We bless them for their love and passion to lead and teach for the love of Christ. And oh, Lord, grant them patience. My son is in that program too. We bless the Lord in the mighty, mighty, mighty name of Jesus. And again, all of God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Now, y'all need to know, my best. Y'all need to know how proud I am of these young men and women, and that God would allow us to partner with them in what they're doing. This week, we'll be finishing up our study in the book of James. And last week, in the sermon, he said that if we wait on the Lord, as Scripture commands, we will be blessed for enduring. All of us go through trials and temptations, so it was good to hear that if we wait on the Lord, as Scripture commands, we will be blessed for enduring. And we said last week that we needed to be patient in trials, and we needed to refrain from complaining, and that we needed to follow biblical examples given to us in the Bible to model out what it is to be patient and suffering. And this week, as we finish up the book of James, we'll revisit a couple of earlier themes. But please keep in mind that James is the half-brother of Jesus, and he is what we would refer to as a moral theologian because he teaches us practical ways to apply solid biblical truths. And I think it's pretty built upon the end of this book today with our common interns and their families as well as our church, and let me tell you why. In the same way that James opened up this letter by speaking to us of encountering trials, so he begins to close his letter in the same way, telling us to be patient in suffering and to wait on But as he ends this letter, he also reminds us that although we have to remain patient in trials, we are to be a people of action. That is not a contradiction. Remaining patient in trials does not mean that we just sit there twiddling our thumbs waiting for God to drop his blessing out of the sky for us. When things are going wrong, life goes on. We've got responsibilities to take care of, a roof to put over our heads, and food to put on our tables. Homework to get done. When things don't go our way, when we get curveballs thrown at us, we don't just cross our arms, pout, and play the victim. We don't stop going to church, we don't stop worshiping God, and we don't isolate. We don't isolate ourselves, because that gives the enemy a foothold into our lives. So what do? We take action. As James ends this letter, he gives us very specific actions that we must take. They're not suggestions. They're not like, oh, by the way, if you've got some free time, you may want to consider this. Or perhaps you may want to consider going to church. You may want to consider praying if you've got time. That means we don't do church. We don't come to church. We are the church. The Holy Spirit lives within us. This is a building, and we are grateful for the building. For we, the people, we are the church of Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Come on, say that you have to be proud of. We are the Lord's church. Amen?
Amen.
God chose us as broken individuals. I have no idea why, but I will not question him. I will be grateful that his Holy Spirit decided to live within me. So, if you have your Bible, please open up to the book of James, chapter 5, and we'll be going to the very end. James, chapter 5, and we'll be going from verses 12 through 20 to the end of it. Then we get a solid amen when you found James 5 in your Bible, or when your eyes are locked on the screens. And I would ask you that if you would please rise with me in body, word, and spirit for the reading of God's word. The Word of God reads as follows, starting at verse 12. Above all, my brothers and sisters, do not swear, either by heaven or by earth or with any other oath, but let your yes mean yes and your no mean no, so that you won't fall under judgment. Is anyone among you suffering? He should pray. Is anyone cheerful? He should sing praises. Is anyone among you sick? He should call for the elders of the church, and they are to pray over him, anointing with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of the faith will save the sick person, and the Lord will raise him up. If he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you might be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is very powerful in its effect. Elijah was a human being as we are. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and for 3 years and 6 months it did not rain on the land. Then he prayed again, and the sky gave rain, and the land produced its fruit. My brothers and sisters, if any among you strays from the truth, and someone turns him back, let that person know that whoever turns a sinner from the error of his way will save his soul from death. Cover a multitude of sins. People of God, this is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated, gentlemen. That was a mouthful that we heard from James, right? We could actually do a whole sermon series based on this passage. But I'd like to focus on the call to action. And my argument this afternoon is this, that if we say we are a people of faith, we are called to action no matter what is happening in our lives. If we say we are a people of faith, we are called to action no matter what is happening in our lives. And I'd like to address this argument by drawing your attention to the following things. As believers in the risen Christ, we are called to 1. Radical honesty. 2. We are called to action. 3. We are called to mutual confession and prayer. And 4, we're called to bringing back the lost. Amen? So if we are a people of faith, we are called to action, and no matter what is happening in your life, whether you're having highs Some people are like, that's not everything. That's not all I'm on. That's all the good. That's all I'm made from. And I dare say that some people have even said, that's not God. Now, what in the world could be so important that someone felt it so necessary to involve God, the creator of all things, just that somebody would believe what they were saying? Isn't it sad that folks would even resort to such things? Put it on somebody. You feel like you got involved in the creator of all things so that this person you were speaking to would believe the veracity of what you're saying. We've been called to radical honesty. Now, I can see people that don't believe in Jesus doing something like this. We're not Christians. One of the marks of a Christian should be that folks can trust us. That we're not lying to them. We're not trying to get them for their money. That we don't have some kind of ulterior motive. We just want to love them and show them the love of Christ. We don't have to put that on something. We should just be able to speak things and people believe us. But the reality is that we're also used to being lied to, that we feel we just can't trust people. The media lies to us all the time. Commercials that will say, if you eat this or drink that or buy that product, you're going to look a certain way, you're going to feel a certain way. But sometimes, if we look into real, we have to say truthful things that might just hurt somebody's feelings. So we're lied. And that's not cool either. We hear it in Ephesians 4:15, but speaking the truth in love, let us grow in every way into Him who is the head, Christ. And Proverbs 12:22 says that lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, but those who act faithfully are His delight. So, let us not be scared of speaking the truth. And let us be wise in doing so in love. And begin creating a Christ-likeness within us that oaths aren't necessary. And for the record, I'm not saying that taking an oath is a sin. If you gotta go to jury duty or testify in court, you have to swear an oath before you get up and testify. But let us begin to break the cycle in which we feel the need to use an oath just to have people believe that we're telling them the truth. May we be a people that are known for being radically honest. Jesus' prayer to God the Father was this, that we would be sanctified in the truth. But that means God's word is truth. May that be our guide always. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Proverbs 19:1 serves as a reminder. It says, better is a poor person who walks in integrity than one who is crooked in speech and is a fool. Let's talk about integrity. The second call to action today comes from verses 13, 14, and 15. It reads, is anyone among you suffering? You should pray. Is anyone cheerful? You should sing praises. Is anyone among you sick? You should call for the elders of the church, and they are to pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. It says that the prayer of faith will save the sick person, and the Lord will raise him up. If he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Did you hear that? If you are sick, pray. If you are cheerful, sing. If you're sick, call the elders of the church. And their call to action too, it says that they will pray and anoint you with oil. If we say we are a people of faith, we are called to action no matter what is happening in our lives. Now, this call to action is a very important one, especially because it concerns praying for those that are sick. But I need to be very clear, and I need to remind you of something. This healing isn't always physical. At some point in time, you will all get sick, and you will not recover. When it's our time to go home and be with the Lord, no amount of oil or praying will stop that from happening. not always God's will for a sick person to be healed. As much as we pray, as much as we hope, as much as we want to get, it's not always God's will for somebody sick to get well. God can heal any disease, any person, at any time, using any means. But that doesn't mean that it will always happen. But what should always happen is this, that we pray. Philippians 4:6 reminds us not to be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Let's look at this divine prescription for healing. It says, if you are sick, then the sick person should call for the elders. And the elders are to anoint and pray with in the name of Jesus. It says, the prayer of faith will save the sick person, and the Lord will raise them up. How? Listen to this. If they've committed sins, the Lord will forgive them. And that is what this is ultimately about. Being forgiven. I also need to make sure that I stress the fact that we are to be a people of faith. Not just a faith that hopes God can heal us, but if we have true faith, we know that God is sovereign and that we should trust His will no matter what. I know that it can sound hard sometimes, but we should pray in faith that God can heal and that He may or may not heal us physically. But these prayers should never be done as a last resort. It should never be a last resort type of prayer. John Blanchard writes in his book, Truth for Life, that prayer offered in faith is circular in shape. It begins and it ends in heaven in the sovereign will of God. It begins and ends in heaven in the sovereign will of God. And our Savior Himself tells us in Mark 11:24 that whatever we ask in prayer, believe that we have received it, and it will be ours. Now, how can we get that to happen? It's easy. If we always pray for God's will, our prayers will be answered. If we always pray for God's will, our prayers will be answered. A third call to action in this passage is that we are called to mutual confession and prayer. Verses 16 through 18 read as follows. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you might be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is very powerful in its effect. Elijah was a human as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and for 3 years and 6 months it did not rain on the land. Then he prayed again, and the sky gave rain, and the land produced its fruit. You catch that again? Once again, we are commanded to pray. We are told to confess our sins and pray for each other. It's mutual. It's not one-sided. And you make it very clear that nowhere in the Bible does it say that we, men and women, have the authority to forgive sins as God does. Only Jesus has done that. And I say this because many of us have been raised in a faith that demands that we confess our sins to a priest and that he will give us a specific recipe or ingredient of repentant prayers that we may be forgiven. That is not what the Bible says. That's just not true. When Jesus healed people, instead of just healing them, he'd say often to the person that he healed, he'd say that their sins were forgiven. In the Gospels of Mark and Matthew, there's a story of a paralytic man that his friends wanted to get up in close to see Jesus, but there were so many people that they just couldn't get into the building. So these guys were smart. They kind of hold the roof and they lowered their buddy into the hole. Jesus told the paralytic man, he said, that his sins are forgiven. And the Pharisees, they accused Jesus of blaspheming because only God could forgive sins. Newsflash. Jesus is God. Jesus is God. So Jesus, in response to the Pharisees, said this in Matthew 9:5-8. He says, what is easier to say? That your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise and walk? but so that you may know that the Son of Man has the authority on earth to forgive sins, even for the paralytic man who said, rise, pick up your bed, and go home. And what did the paralytic man do? He got up, and he rose, and he went home. And it says that when the crowd saw it, they were afraid, and they glorified God. God is sovereign, and everything he does will always be for his glory. And mutual prayer and confession, it also brings help not just to the individual, but to the church as a whole. If everyone goes around pretending like everything's okay, like we're holier than thou, like everything is great, and Harry asks, how are you doing? I am blessed by the best. How are you doing? I can say in Spanish, estoy de mi gloria. That may very well be true, but we know that life isn't always good. And we sin every single day. We have clear instructions here that we are to confess our sins to each other and pray. Now, a word of wisdom. Be careful who you confess to. Be wise in who you open up to. Don't feel the need to confess your sins to the whole church. Don't put your stuff on that. Don't put it on social media. Really bigger. Find someone you trust. Someone with a good reputation, not a gossip, and someone who is spiritually mature. That they might listen, that they might pray, and that you be healed. Not just for me, but healed. Only God can be sin. But also something to point out is this, that James says that the power of a righteous person is very powerful in its effect. Isn't that amazing? Like, there is power in prayer. There is power in the prayer of a righteous person. And that should just be another incentive for us to be holy and to strive for righteousness, that our prayers may be that much more powerful. And he gave us the example of Elijah, who was a man just like you and me. Prayer is important. What better thing to offer our friends and our family and our church and our community and even our enemies, that there be so much power in our prayer that things can change. Amen? R. Kent Hughes said that here, James has been telling us that all of life is to be bathed in prayer. Prayers when we are down, prayers when in song when we are up, prayers for the sick, and now prayers for each other. Prayer is important not just when things are bad, not just as a cry out to God, but also for praise, to thank him. 1 Thessalonians 5:7 says that we should pray without ceasing. That means never stop praying. Ephesians 6:18 says, pray at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. John Chrysostom in the 4th century said this about prayer. Pay attention. It says, the potency of prayer has subdued the strength of fire. It has bridled the rage of lions. It has hushed anarchy to rest. Prayer has extinguished wars, appeased the elements, and expelled demons. Prayer has burst the chains of death, expanded the face of heaven, and assuaged diseases. Prayer has dispelled clouds, rescued cities from destruction, stayed the sun in its course, and arrested the progress of chemical war. There is a treasure, undiminished, a mine which is never exhausted. It is the root of a thousand, the mother of a thousand blessings. That is how powerful and effective prayer can be. May we always be a people of prayer. May we be bathed in prayer at all times, for all reasons, and for all seasons. Let this be a distinctive for all of us, that we would be known as a people of prayer. Because if we say we are a people of faith, we are called to action, no matter what is happening in our lives. And the final call is to bring back the lost. To bring back the lost. Verses 19 and 20 say, my brothers and sisters, if any of you strays from the truth and someone turns him back, let that person know that whoever turns a sinner from his error will save the soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. Now this right here, if we're going to be honest, can be hard. But it shouldn't be. Because if we keep it real, like really, really keep it real with each other, there are some of us that have been really hurt by people in the church. Like really, really hurt. And if we see them no longer walking with the Lord, we actually might not want to bring them back to the Lord because they hurt. But let me tell you right now, that is not an option. We should always fight to bring them back. I mean, we can't physically force them back here, but we can pray for them. We can try talking to them, and if they flat out refuse, we can stand before the Lord and say, Lord, I tried. I did everything I could. Let me read you from Matthew 18:15, where he says, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault. Between you and him alone, if he listens to you, you have gained the brother. It doesn't say go tell the church your business. Tell everyone about what's happening. It says go and tell your brother his fault. If he listens to you, you have gained the brother. And if you want to talk about fighting, answering the call to bring back the lost, let's look at Jesus. Let us go no further than Jesus. Think about it. In the very beginning, God created man and women, right? He created mankind to be in complete fellowship with him. But what happened in the garden? Adam and Eve sinned, right? They sinned. And that separated us from God. We're now under his wrath. There must be payment. We are now criminals in the eyes of God. Think about that. We are all criminals because we have sinned against the Holy God. But God showed his love for us and he created a path to come back to him and to be in complete fellowship with him. And that path is who?
Jesus.
Christ. That path is Christ. Christ came into the very world that he created. He was tempted in every way we were, yet he didn't sin. He went willingly to the cross, a perfect, spotless sacrifice. Died in the workplace and reminded that if anybody should have faith in him, they would be saved. He was born, he died, he was crucified, he resurrected, and he ascended to the right hand of the Father. You want to talk about fighting for somebody? What a perfect example we have in Christ. Galatians 6:1 says that, brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. This doesn't mean hit him upside the head with the Bible and tell him how screwed up he is. It says return him in a spirit of gentleness. And Luke 17:3 says, if your brother sins, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. Remember how I started out today saying that James said we need to be radically honest. Sometimes we've got to have difficult conversations. For people's eternity, their salvation, is worth somebody getting their feelings hurt for. We are to hold each other accountable in our Christian walk. People don't just leave church, they don't just stop coming to church. There's usually something going on, and many times it's called sin. Too often folks will stop coming because something is not right. And they know that if they keep coming to church, eventually somebody will realize what's happening in their lives. That's exactly what the enemy wants. He wants us isolated. He wants us alone. He wants us to not know what's right and wrong. He wants to get in our head. He wants us to believe that the wrong things we're doing are actually okay. And that's not going to happen if we're plugged into church. That's not going to happen if we're confessing mutually and praying for each other. So what do we do with this? How do we apply this to our lives practically? You have to ask. You've got four things for you really quick. The first is be known for radical honesty. And the second is be an active Christian. And the third is be known as a safe place. And the last is be someone that fights for your brothers and sisters. Be known for radical honesty. It may take some time, but don't feel the need to prove your level of honesty by swearing. Let yourself know for being honest. Let your yes be yes and your no be no. 2 Corinthians 8:21 says, "For we aim at what is honorable, not only in the Lord's sight, but also in the sight of men." 2, let us be active Christians. Most of us were very active in the world. Don't come to church and try to retire from Jesus. 1 Timothy warns us about idleness. It says, "They yearn to be idlers, going about from house to house." And not only idlers, but also gossips and busybodies saying what they should not. Stay busy in the Lord at all times, because idleness is all bad. So to see all these youth involved in something this summer, and not just being idle at home, waiting to be tempted and fall into sin, is amazing. And third is, be known as a safe place. Be somebody that somebody would gladly go to you and confess, because they know that you truly love them. They know that you are somebody that they can trust. Somebody that they can confess to. Someone that loves them and will pray for them. Proverbs 11:3 says, "Whoever goes about slandering reveals secrets, but he who is trustworthy in spirit keeps a thing covered." Let us be one of those people. And the last is, be somebody that fights for your brothers and sisters. Let's not give up on each other. When you see somebody falling away, when you see somebody not coming to church, when you see them posting dumb stuff on social media, get at them. Remind them of their worth and who they are in Christ. Let them know that they are loved, that they are cared for, that they are being prayed for. Amen? Proverbs 17:17 says, a friend loves at all times, and a brother is born for adversity. Let us be that brother and sister who does not give up on each other, that we will fight for each other, even if feelings there, because salvation is at stake. Eternity is a long time. Y'all think it's hot right now? Imagine what it would be like to get out. Family, may you be people known for radical honesty. May you remain always active in our faith. May we be known as a safe place that people will come and trust in us. And may we never stop fighting for those we love. Amen? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for today's message and for the reminder from James how to practically apply solid biblical truths to our life. Lord, may your Holy Spirit guide us in everything we do, in word, in speech, in conduct, in actions, those things that we say, those things that we should have said and did. May we be known as people that can be trusted. May we never stop fighting for each other, because Lord, you did stop fighting for us. You went to the cross and went willingly. Give us what we need to fight for each other, and not one another. Father, prepare our hearts for what you have in store. Show us Christ in all that we do. And all God's people said,
amen. Thank you, Pastor Rudy. And now, church, hear the words of the institution of the Holy Supper of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul taught us in 1 Corinthians 11, 23-26, "The Lord Jesus, the night when he was betrayed, took bread, while he had given thanks and broken it and said, 'This is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This is the cup, but this cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" And so finally, we give thanks at this time to the Lord Jesus Christ for this gift that he has given us, that we are able to come and celebrate and rejoice over that precious death that took place 2,000 years ago for our sins. And we come in a celebratory posture to give thanks for that. However, the scripture continues by saying, "Whoever therefore eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. But a person examining himself then must eat the bread and drink the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself." So we are given this warning to make sure that we do not take of the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner. That simply means
examine ourselves in a moment of silent confession before God. Holy Spirit, strengthen our faith as we partake of the bread of God. Together as one body, may we be united in hope and love until you, Lord Jesus, return again. Amen.
Amen.
This bread which we break is sharing in the body of Christ. And this cup for which we give thanks is sharing in the blood of Christ. And now, congregation of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord Jesus has promised to be spiritually present in our midst in a very special way for all those who love God and trust in Jesus alone for the forgiveness of their sins. The blue cup.
family, please hold up your hands and receive this blessing from the Lord that says, may the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look with favor upon you.